Salut tout le monde, j'espère que vous allez bien. I've got a special video to bring to you today because I'm interviewing a French native speaker and fellow French coach, Angèle Préteau from FrenchFluency.net. Not only is he a native French speaker and a coach, he's also a polyglot speaking five languages, I think. So before we get started, Angèle, do you want to introduce yourself? Tell us a bit more about who you are and what you do.
You introduced me pretty nicely. So I'm Angèle Préteau. I own the website FrenchFluency.net. I also have a YouTube channel, which I'm sure you can link around or below somehow. And my job is to be a French learning coach. I work mostly with English speakers who are learning French, often for work or family related reasons. So contrary to you, Alex, I don't work only with people who live in France. I specialize more with people who are going to travel to French speaking countries from time to time, often for work or for charity work. And I help them just really learn French for the goals, the specific goals that they have. Because often when you go to a French class or you use an app or really any of the mainstream options, it doesn't really teach you the French that you need, especially if you have very specific goals, such as to like quote things that I've been having with my students, like building a hospital or like even working at a hospital in Africa, for example, or running a part of a business or speaking to the people that you have to work with who are in French speaking countries, that kind of things. Often it's just not covered. So that's what I specialize in. And as you said, I am a polyglot. I like to say that I speak six languages. They're not all six always at the same level because it's almost impossible to keep languages at the same level. But yeah, so French is my native language. I'm originally from Dijon. English, as you can hear, that's the language that I believe I master the best, actually even better than my native language right now. It's perhaps even easier for me to speak English than to speak French at this point in my life. So we can speak about that if you want. I live in Vienna, Austria, and I've been living in German-speaking countries for 10 years. So German is covered, and the other three I have are Spanish, Portuguese, and Esperanto. So yeah, hopefully that answers your question.
Definitely. No, what a great introduction. I'm sure people are thinking, first of all, wow, that's an amazing amount of languages. And secondly, Esperanto. Some people may not have even come across that one before. So we're going to maybe talk a little bit about that later on. So I know that you mentioned the importance of goal setting there, which is something that we have in common, that we both help our students with. One thing I want to start off with is, because you're an expat, you're a language learner, you're a language lover, you've, like you say, you've mastered English, perhaps more than your native language. But first of all, I want to take you back to if you can go back that far in your mind, remember like when you first moved out of France and to your first country, which I believe was Germany, but you can correct me if I'm wrong. I'm sure you recognize in English speakers that fear of speaking French when they're learning with you or before they started learning with you. Did you have that when you first had to start speaking German because you were living there? Can you tell us a bit about your beginnings? And also, like, do you recognize the same fear in English speakers, or is it a bit different?
Yeah, that's a great question. I would say it's partially different and partially the same. It's a bit, my case is a bit special, so I'm happy to talk about that. The first country that I moved to was actually Austria. I basically lived in Austria, then Germany, then Austria. And the first place specifically I moved to was Gmunden. It's a little town in the Alps in Upper Austria. I was a French assistant there. That was over 10 years ago. And when I first moved there, I was not afraid to speak. But that wasn't going to last because when I moved to Gmunden, so Austria is a German speaking country. That's at least what I learned back in the days. I mean, I think anyone who has some like education about the countries of Europe knows that in Austria, they speak German, or at least we think they do. But that was basically how much I knew. For me, Austria, Germany, same language. And my German at the time was about A2, I would say. I had a couple classes. I've been striving to learn German for a long time and absolutely failing at it, but you know, well, failing. I was up to level A2, so I could go to Germany. I'd done that a couple of times. I could go to a restaurant, read the menu, order something, and everything went well as long as the waiter didn't ask specific questions, such as, how do you want your steak done? I once had that situation, I was like, unplanned, what am I gonna do now? So that was my kind of level, but I was already speaking actually all of those languages. Like German was the last one that I learned. So I was not too scared. I would think my situation was different from that of an English speaker who was moving to France or to a French-speaking country, because I was used to at least speaking English. And for me, the mere fact of speaking a foreign language was not the problem. The problem was that when I arrived in Gmunden, I found out that they don't really speak German there.
Okay, what do they speak? Some regional dialect?
Totally unexpected. And I was with a friend who was moving there with me, and he spoke perfect German. So for me, like, if I would run into a problem, I would have just asked him, you know? But he spoke, you know, academic German, the German from Germany, the German that educated German speakers speak, not the dialect that they speak over there in the Alps, where they live in their village and they don't see why anyone would want to live anywhere else or move anywhere else or even travel. And for them, that's German. They are absolutely convinced that what they speak is German and that what the others speak is kind of wrong in some ways, even if the others live 10 kilometers away from in the next village where they have a slightly different dialect, but they don't understand each other or they pretend not to. So you take me, 25-year-old French assistant who's moving there and was told that for the job, he doesn't even need to speak German because that's not part of the job requirement. You're just supposed to speak French to the student and you speak English anyway, so you're going to be fine. And oh, you have the A2 German, perfect. I don't know if the people who appointed me there knew of the language thing. What I know is that the first time I heard of that language thing was that I had this training for French assistants. And we were told that on occasions, in some parts, they would speak a dialect. And I was like, oh, that's interesting. It's like, you know, patois in French. Like my great grandparents, they used to speak a bit of a different variant. I was like, oh, folklore, great. No, I'm telling you, it's not folklore. It's what they speak all day, every day, even in class. And the immigrants there, like, you know, the people from Turkey or Croatia that immigrated to that part of Austria, they speak their native language, so Turkish or Croat or whatever it is, and the dialect. No English, no German. You don't need even to speak German there. You need to read it a bit because it's written, but you don't need to speak it. And everybody is expecting you to speak like they do. And at this point, when I realized that, I started being scared.
But what do they call it? You say that they consider that German and
They call it Deutsch, which means German.
so they call it Deutsch, okay.
Yeah, so basically, they make a difference between Deutsch, which means German, and Hochdeutsch, which is High German, if you translate it literally, and that's what they write. That's the written German that we learn in school. But for them, it's not a real language. It's just a thing they write.
So
Similarly to
what
perhaps in the Middle Ages, you know, Latin was written and whichever other language was spoken. It's just like that. It's crazy for me.
And if the people obviously in the cities and the rest of Germany, if those who know about this place and that language, what do they call it? Would they call that? Would
Or
they
they
call
would
that?
call it a dialect.
Yeah. Okay.
And I mean, all over Austria, there are dialects. And fun fact, I mean, I later lived in Berlin, and even in Berlin, there is a dialect, which is very different. But most people don't speak it. It's only people who, like electricians or the people who have manual work, that would speak the dialect and would not be able to speak the so-called High German.
Yeah.
So, in German, and even here, I live in Vienna now. And most people would still, they speak with a strong accent, but they still speak High German. They would be understood by the Germans, mostly. But like, to give you an anecdote like that, at some point I was married with a German woman. And when we were in Vienna, at some point we were in an elevator with two old ladies who were speaking a dialect. And my wife, who is German, turned to me and like she often did, she was like, what language are those people speaking? Because, you know, she knew that I was a polyglot. So whenever she heard a foreign language, she was like, oh, what language are they speaking? Because she would assume that I would be able to tell her. And often, you know, it was Spanish or something easy. So I told her, and I was like, German. She's like, no. Are you kidding me? This isn't German. I was like, but I understand it. Well, I don't. And that's how different it is, like so different that a native German speaker from Germany cannot understand them.
Yeah, and it's not that they're being snobby. It's like they actually don't understand it. Because I'm referring to yeah, I'm referring to like Swiss German, which a lot of Germans would say that's not German, right? But they'll understand enough to communicate and stuff. But
Well, they can come, like, if both make a lot of efforts, they can communicate. But if the, like, one of them is making no efforts, the communication will not go through. And unfortunately, that was the situation I was often when I was in Gmunden. And at this point, yeah, I was scared. I was like, how am I going to deal with that?
Okay, so that's a fantastic story, and I think that people will be thinking like okay, that's amazing, probably quite unique journey in terms of how he started out with his languages. They can't really relate to it for their own situations, but so I want to link that to.
In France, you at least don't have this problem because the dialects have mostly been eradicated. So French is pretty much uniform all over the country. So you won't have this issue at least.
I want to link this to the thing which a lot of us do too much, but I think we can't stop it completely, and that is comparison with others and their level of language, either with a native or with someone who is learning the same language. So for us, French. Like, are you aware of this? What do you advise people to do who are saying, oh, I can't speak as well as him, or I can't speak as well as her, and they get themselves down? Like, how do you help them overcome that?
Yeah, so there are really two things I would like to say to the people who feel they can't speak as well as X, because there are really two cases that I've been seeing where you want to watch out for those two. First, I have a whole bunch of students who love to watch language learning videos on YouTube, and they see, oh my God, the polyglots, they speak so many languages, or like French learners, like perhaps you, I mean, if they watch your interview on my channel, which we can link somewhere, oh wow, he speaks French so well. Well, in your case, it's an interview, so it's a bit less curated than the average YouTube video. But like many people who make YouTube videos where they speak French, where they have learned French, it's very carefully curated. They select the topic, and they perhaps make cuts. They perhaps you know, it's a selection, it's a snapshot. And even if we take your interview, I mean, you obviously speak French very well. But it's after, I believe, 5 years being in France, and you speak about topics that you're extremely familiar with. You speak about your work, you speak about yourself, some of it like personal experience. So that's still a snapshot. Like, I didn't try to take you to a topic where it would be extremely difficult for you to speak French. And often, what they do is that they compare the whole of their experience, which like the topics that they can speak about, but the topics that they struggle with too, to like just a snippet. And the snippet is, I mean, if you're on YouTube and the person you have put the video on YouTube yourself, or the person who has put it is a nice person who doesn't want to make you look bad, it will be selected. And you cannot compare the selection that you see, which is specifically at least selected to not make the person look bad, to your experience where we have a negativity bias anyway. So we will see our mistakes more than what we do well.
We're very good at that, yeah.
That is one thing. You need to know that what you see of your experience is very different. Like, your entire experience is very different from the snippet. And like the entire experience of that person and how they feel about it is very different from the snippets that you're seeing. So that's one case that's very important. And the second case is if you see someone in real life that you're like, oh my God, this person speaks French so much better than me. Actually, I can tell you a really interesting anecdote about that to let you just understand how much it is, because you will think of yourself more negatively than of the other person. And I can illustrate that with a story. Once I was with my ex-wife and a friend who also speaks Spanish. And this friend and myself, we had never spoken Spanish, not never. We hadn't spoken Spanish in a long time, and we were like, okay, great. We are, you know, that was in Germany. The opportunity to speak Spanish were scarce.
You mean separately, or you're not speaking together Spanish for a while?
We had never spoken together, and we haven't spoken separately for a while. We were like, okay, great opportunity to practice. And my ex-wife was just sitting there, and she was not understanding any Spanish. So we were having a conversation in Spanish for maybe, you know, 10, 15 minutes. And at some point, my ex-wife asked, okay, what just happened? Like, what did you speak about? Because she didn't understand a word. And my friend said, okay, what happened is that Angel speaks amazing Spanish and I sucked. And I was like, oh, well, how I saw it was that you were speaking great Spanish and I was struggling.
Yeah.
So you don't often have the two, like, it's just because my ex-wife asked the question that we were to see the two sides of that story. In real life, you're just like, oh my God, he speaks so much better than me and I suck. And if she hadn't asked the question, I would have stayed in the situation of, oh my God, he speaks so great and I'm struggling. So keep in mind that what you like, the way you see yourself is different from how other people see you. And the way they see themselves, they probably see them more negatively than you see them. So that's very important.
So true, so true. And we do it like the negativity bias that you said. Yeah, it's really nice to put a label on that. And I think you guys watching this who have a tendency to do that, and I still do it as well. Like I say, it's a very human thing. I think you need to you train yourself over time to remind yourself to step out of your head, if you like, step out of your body for a second and just look at the bigger picture, and then you will see that. And it helps if you get someone who gives you this comment out of the blue that they thought you were speaking amazing. But you won't always have that. You just have to remind yourself how good you are and what you've achieved up to this point. And yeah, that's really, really important.
Like a piece of advice, perhaps, that I can give that I like to give to people to measure more accurately their language competence is, does it work? So I often speak about tasks in my work. So a task is just something you want to do using the French language. I mean, it's not a French task, is something you want to do using the French language. And if what you say what you want to do is to enter a bakery and buy some bread, and you speak French throughout, and you get out of the bakery with bread, and that's the bread you wanted, then it's a 100%. We don't care how many mistakes you have been making, how wrong it could have gone. Like, there's no like, because I know so many students or like so many French learners who would go out of the bakery with their bread, and it would be a complete success by my metric, but by their metric, it's like, oh, I suck so much. You don't care. Like, honestly, at the end of the day, it's not some imaginary, hairy, fairy idea of like what perfect French should look like. So the question is it working? And that's like level one. And if you really want to make it harder, is it smooth? Typically, that corresponds to like B1. B1 is like you can do whatever you need to do, but it's not smooth. And if it's smooth, then it's B2. And honestly, when you're at the point where you do everything you want and it's smooth, that's, well, it's not the best you can expect, because if you're really like into learning French, you can always get better. But by my book, you do everything you need to do and it's smooth, then that's a success. You don't have to beat yourself up over anything.
Yeah, and that's a great point. And you've got to have clear expectations of what constitutes success after even just a small task. Because if you don't, you're opening yourself up to what I would call like a confidence catastrophe. Because you're like, before you go into the bakery, how are you going to know when you walk out that you are happy with your French? Well, you say to yourself, okay, I just got to go in and get a baguette. Une baguette pas trop cuite, for example. That's a big one for me. I was like, I heard this one day, I wanted to learn it, I wanted to make sure I got a specific baguette, and then I learned how to say celle en haut, juste à côté de celle qui est plus cuite que l'autre, si tu veux. And so I told myself today, to have a successful trip to the bakery, I want to get a specific baguette from the shelf. But that's more advanced. If you're lower down, you've got to know, like Angel says, like decide before, if I'm just going to go in there, order a baguette, get a baguette, come out, that's success for me because I haven't done that before. Do that so you know afterwards, you say, I've achieved that. I can reward myself today, for example, you know. But have a goal. Yeah.
It's about really being very specific on your goal. And especially once you have achieved your goal, do not come up with an excuse to think that you suck.
Yeah, oh my God.
So many people, oh yeah, I did what I wanted to do, but this and this and that.
Yeah, next time.
No, you did what you wanted to do, that's it.
It's yeah, we all too often want the result, and the result in our heads is fluency far too soon. And I know it's painful and it takes a long time to get there, but the tried and true and tested method is to, in my experience, and I think you'd agree, is to set step-by-step goals and achieve them one by one until you get to that point.
I think one thing with fluency that it tends to piss me off, like, and my website is frenchfluency.net, so I piss myself off too. But I find there is a certain amount of laziness, perhaps in particular in marketing materials, that, or like in the mind of people who aren't really learning a language, that fluency is like the ideal goal. But as soon as you ask people to define it, they're like, I don't know, just fluency. No, but you have to know, because if you don't, you'll never get there. You cannot hit a target that you can't see. So we have really sold this idea of fluency I mean, I like to blame the marketers for that. It's just, it's easy to market because everybody has like the idea of fluency, and it works only in English, by the way. Like if you try to translate it to French, you don't really like, I mean, I don't know, parler couramment or whatever, but.
I did a video on this, yeah. And it came up, the first thing, it's like, I translated it on Google and you have aisance ou maîtrise, but there's no word for fluent. There's just that adverb, and that kind of annoys me as an English speaker trying to say it in French, but there you go.
Yeah, it's annoying, but that's when you realize that fluency doesn't really mean, it's the meaning of it is not clear enough that another language has a word for it too.
No. So you have to define it yourself.
Fluency is really fuzzy, and it sounds really nice on marketing materials, because for some reason you can sell it. Or at least you can sell something that has the word fluency or fluent on it. But actual fluency, to have it, to become fluent, and you need first to have an idea of what it means. And that's really tricky. And in my French program, the French Fluency Accelerator, and in actually all of my programs when I work one-on-one with a client, it's the same as well. The first task is, okay, we want to know where you are going. And it's not final. You don't have to define it once and for all, and then it's set in stone and you'll never go farther than that, or you'll never be able to change it. But at any given point in your study, you need to have an idea of what will you be like? What will you be doing? How will you speak when you will be fluent? Because if you don't, you can trust that you'll never get there, because it's a place that doesn't exist.
Yeah.
So it's really, you want to be specific. And I think there is a certain amount of laziness also, because if you're just selling books or you're just selling courses, it's easy to just say fluent and then sell whatever with it. And then it doesn't really work, or it works a bit and the students get frustrated, but it doesn't matter because you've sold your thing. That's not how I see teaching or coaching a person to learn French. What I see is that I want to know where the person is going, and I want to help them get there. That's a lot more tricky to sell, by the way. But originally, you know, I'm a French guy who has studied how to learn languages, and I'm trying to learn marketing on the job. And so I'm very different in my approach to someone who's a marketer and is like, okay, let's sell something and then we figure out if it works. It's the opposite. I'm like, okay, I have this thing which works. Now, how do I sell it? Makes my job a lot harder as a person who's running an online business, but it's also fascinating. So yeah, I'm fine with it.
It is fascinating. And something else fascinating, just we'll bring it back to the language, because we can't not talk about Esperanto a little bit in this video, because we mentioned it at the top, and honestly, there's not much I know about it apart from, I believe it was called a constructed language or something like that. So I'd really love just to tell us firstly, like, what is Esperanto? Why do you speak it? And if you have any like funny anecdotes about it.
Sure. So yes, Esperanto is a constructed language. That is great. Of course, if you've never heard the phrase constructed language before, you're like, okay, what the hell?
Yeah, what does that mean? Yeah.
What does that mean? So the languages that we deal with, you and I, English and French, are so-called natural languages. Now, we can discuss that for a long time, because the languages that are natural are often also a little bit constructed. For example, there's the Académie Française, who tries to like put their grain of salt into the French language and, you know, like stir it in some direction. But mostly those are languages that have evolved naturally through time, coming from Latin in the case of French, and English is a mixture of French and the Germanic language, and they just evolved naturally. So that's why we call them natural languages. And we also have constructed languages, and those are languages that have been created from scratch, basically, often by a single person. You can just trace it down to one person who created it. And for example, for Esperanto, it's Ludwig Zamenhof, who created it in the 19th century. There's even a date, 1887. So, you know, if you can trace back to the point when the language appears, it's probably constructed. And most constructed languages, you can actually see them in fiction. So for example, in the movie Avatar, there's a Na'vi language, which was created just for Avatar. Oh,
like Elvish as well.
Elvish is a great example. It was created by Tolkien. You can trace it back to Tolkien and roughly the time when he made it. Actually, Tolkien, I believe, created 4 or 5 languages just for his universe, The Lord of the Rings and the other novels. He was just a crazy linguist. And some people actually like to create languages for fun. Like you have projects of people who create languages just, you know, throughout. But most of these languages don't have a vocation or a goal to be spoken by masses or by many people. So Esperanto is by far the most successful constructed languages, because there's millions of people who speak it. So it's difficult to get an exact estimate because it's challenging, you know, they're all over the world, but some estimates are that there are about 10 million speakers. And no other constructed language can brag about ever having had 10 million speakers, you know, like not Volapük, not Klingon.
Not Klingon, no, I was thinking of.
I think Klingon is the second.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
I'm not so sure because Toki Pona probably comes a close third, but I'm getting nerdy here. So there are a whole bunch of constructed languages, but Esperanto is by far the most successful. Every weekend, okay, not right now because pandemics and all, but every weekend somewhere in the world, you can be sure there's some Esperanto gathering happening somewhere. And the really big ones have hundreds of people or sometimes thousands of people who just travel to that place for the sake of speaking Esperanto. And that's really interesting because often when you speak Esperanto, even if you have more languages in common with the person, it's easier to use Esperanto than any other language. Like if both speak Esperanto fluently, Esperanto is just so efficient and easy to use that the communication goes better. And the reason is because it was constructed with the goal of being a language that can be used from people who have very different native languages. And it's extremely easy and fast to learn. So for example, I once saw someone learning it in 3 weeks. That was because he spoke French, English, and German, and those are the languages that Esperanto is most based on. And the grammar is so simple that you can learn it in half an hour. The entire grammar of Esperanto will be on one page. So if you compare that to the grammar of French, which is like a full book and you don't even have everything in it.
Why am I not learning that? Like, I should just go off and learn that, right? Yes, makes so much
You could.
sense.
I mean, you can go to lernu.net and it will teach you Esperanto. And that's also the language that transfers the best from learning from a book or a website to speaking in real life, just because it's so simple. And there's no like high variant, like we spoke about German, or like there's no street Esperanto that would be different from book Esperanto. It's all the one language because it's so simple. And it's very elegant. And the vocabulary is built with a system of suffixes and prefixes, which is why it's so easy to learn, because you learn maybe like 20 suffixes and prefixes and a couple of roots, and you can make all the words you want. So it's extremely fast to learn. Some people recommend to learn it first before you learn another language, because it's just a lot easier, and then it gives you an idea of what grammar and how a language works.
Okay, yeah, like you say, we could
Sorry,
probably
I
talk
got
about
nerdy.
it's fine, it's fascinating. It's probably just a bit outside the scope of this one. So if you mentioned, I think you said the word elegant about it. So I know you have a funny anecdote involving toilets, which, you know, I like conversations qui partent en couilles. Tu vois, they go a bit dirty, they go a bit rude. So I don't know if this is going to be one of those, but it involves toilets. So do you have something to say to us about this?
So like I was telling you, there are congresses of Esperanto, and the big ones have like hundreds of people. And that must have been 15 years ago when I went to my first congress. That was only 4 months after I'd started learning Esperanto, and I was able to have a conversation, no problem. And the congress was in the Czech Republic, so I spoke no Czech. And the whole idea of being there was that we had to speak Esperanto. And I arrived at this place and I need to go to the toilet. It was after 20 hours of train. Like, we love to take slow trains because they're cheap. And I mean, I was pretty young too, so the budget was not really huge either. So Esperanto speakers love to organize things so that they can pay a little and spend hours and hours and hours in trains together just having fun. So we arrive at this place. It's like the middle of the night, and I'm in the Czech Republic. I've been speaking Esperanto for the entire day. It's fine. I'm really proud because I've been, you know, learning for 4 months. I can speak it, no problem. But I'm like, I have to go to the toilet. I have no idea how to say toilet in Esperanto because I learned it online, and I hadn't been speaking in real life until that moment, until that day.
You need Duolingo to teach you useless words.
It didn't exist at the time. There was no Esperanto class. It's fairly recent, it's a couple of years old. I used lernu.net, and I just never had, like, you know, I was chatting online, and if I had to go to the toilet, I didn't say, I am going to the toilet. I just went. And at no point I realized that I didn't know this word because I didn't need it. But then I was there and I was like, okay, I have to say, where are the toilet? I can say, where is the toilet? I can say, where is? No problem. I don't say toilet. What I had to do was to find a French person. I was like, sorry, I have a problem. Like, how do you say toilet in Esperanto? And that person was actually a native Esperanto speaker. So that's worth, they had French and Esperanto as native languages both. And she was like, how can you, it's the first word that you need to learn in any language. How can you not know the word toilet?
That's not true, everyone. Do not learn that, no.
I mean, but like, also when I was teaching French to classes, the only sentence that I managed to teach reliably to everyone was, où sont les toilettes? Or like, no, not où sont les toilettes, but est-ce que je peux aller aux toilettes? Like, because the only thing they cared about was going to the toilet, the rest of the class, they didn't care. So in this case, it was the one word they knew. And she was like, yeah, necesario, but how come you don't know the word? I was like, I never needed it. That's the thing. Like, I was chatting online about tons of stuff with people, but toilets was not one of those. So that's, you know, it ties back to the idea of goals. I mean, what is it that you need to achieve with the language? And exactly. Just up until that point, going to the toilet was not something you need to achieve. So yeah, if you ever need to go to the toilet in Esperanto, it's necesario. It literally means necessary, please.
Yeah.
Necessa is necessary, and ayo is the suffix for please.
Okay. Well, I'm going to put down some links about Esperanto down in the description if anyone's curious. I think you said learn.net, but I'll have a look up.
Lernu, so it's lernu.net. Lernu means learn, like as in imperative, because lern is learn and u is the suffix, like the ending for imperative. It always works like that. It's so simple.
Okay, so that's a funny anecdote about Esperanto, but perhaps people won't have necessarily anything to relate that to, because they either Esperanto is completely new to them, or language conferences is completely new to them. But something more in like real everyday life that people can relate to, perhaps with German. Is there anything there that's perhaps embarrassing? Because, you know, like when English speakers and other native speakers, native speakers of other languages tend to be learning French, they'll make embarrassing mistakes like je suis chaud or je suis chaude, things like this. Is there anything like that you had?
In English, once I sent an email that said I love to Netflix and chill to 400 people at the beginning of my business, because I thought it was literal. And someone replied to me, I don't think it means what you think it means. So, yeah.
So what did you think? So when you say you thought it was literal, you thought just watch Netflix and relax.
Watching Netflix and chilling out. I didn't think it had anything to do with sex.
My parents probably think the same, you know. It's not. That's a generation thing as well.
I don't think all those 400 people made fun of me behind their screen, but one person emailed me like, I don't think it means what you think it means. And I had to look up Urban Dictionary and correct my mistake.
It's adapted now, so you can say anything and chill, and it basically implies the same thing. Yeah.
Okay, so chill now means sex.
No, something and chill. If you say we're gonna tennis and chill, you know, they're gonna assume it's something sexual going on. Yeah.
No, I will never look at this word again.
Only for people who also know Netflix and chill, otherwise they will tend to think of it. Also, who's going to say tennis and chill? But it's just a bad example. Wow, to 400 people, was that because your mailing list was 400 people at that time?
Yeah, it was my mailing list. And now it's a lot more. So next time I make an embarrassing mistake, it will be much more embarrassing. But at the time it was 400, yeah.
Did anyone reply to you and say, what do you mean?
Just one person replied to me being like, I know you're not an English native, so you want to check that out. And yeah.
Yeah, imagine all the things that we say that are actually embarrassing, but people don't tell us, you know. So yeah, it's a fraction.
I mean, there were 399 people who got that email and didn't say anything.
Yeah. Well, they're either too nice or just lazy. Yeah.
but as an expat, I have a story with a German word that it's mostly happening in my head, but I got scared a bit, and I like to tell that story to French people because they can somehow relate. It's with the word Anschluss, and if you're French and you've listened in your history class but you've never learned German, you know the word Anschluss from the story of the Second World War, where at some point Hitler, who was a dictator of Germany, invaded Austria. And that invasion of Austria was called Anschluss. And for me, Anschluss meant something like invading, being aggressive, generally not being nice. And I didn't know what the words meant in German. I didn't think it meant anything other than invading Austria. And at this point, I was already living in Vienna, so it was my second year in Austria, and I needed to have my internet installed at home. I just had a new place. I needed to have a new internet connection. And I was told that some guy needed to come to my place. I don't know, I signed up online and I got a message. Some guy needs to come to my place for the Anschluss. And at that point, I saw that word. I'd never seen it ever, you know, I saw it when I was in history class. But since then, I was like, Anschluss, I think it means something with, I mean, I think it's not nice. What the hell? I was alone at my place. Some you know, Austrian guy was to come for the Anschluss.
They found out I'm French living in Austria. They want me out.
Something like that. You know, like there are many people who don't like experts or foreigners or whatever. And I was like, okay, I have to open a dictionary. And it's connection. The word Anschluss is freaking, it means connection. So in Hitler's head, when he invaded the Austrians, which they are still pissed about, he was just connecting two parts of his life. And of course, that wasn't taught to me in history class because I was told that Hitler was a bad guy. He was invading people, you know. The way he saw it was different.
Context is everything.
Right.
Context
is everything. If you're living in a German-speaking country and some Anschluss happens, it's not bad. You're getting connected. It's good.
Yeah. That's funny. I think that's a great reason to bring up the importance of learning new French or learning whatever in context. Learn stuff, not just single words, learn them in a specific context so you can really understand them and also retain them for longer. Ça nous amène peut-être parfaitement à cette dernière partie qu'on va faire en français, si ça te va, Angèle. On va parler des conseils que tu aurais pour apprendre le français, particulièrement pour ceux qui vivent en France en tant qu'expatriés ou dans la francophonie en général. Quelle est la différence pour toi entre apprendre dans un pays anglophone ou dans son propre pays et apprendre en France ou dans la francophonie? Est-ce qu'il y a des conseils particuliers pour ceux qui vivent dans la francophonie?
En général, sur ma chaîne, en général, j'essaie de pas trop faire de différence entre les deux situations parce que je pense que c'est plutôt une question d'attitude. Même si vous n'êtes pas dans un pays francophone, vous pouvez apprendre le français. Il y a beaucoup de gens qui pensent qu'ils doivent aller dans un pays francophone et que c'est le seul moyen d'apprendre le français. Et d'ailleurs, même toi, tu m'as dit dans une interview qu'on a fait sur ma chaîne que tu avais déménagé en France parce que c'était le meilleur moyen pour toi d'apprendre le français. C'est un très bon moyen, ce n'est pas le seul moyen. Mais c'est vrai que quand tu es en France, tu as plus d'opportunités. En fait, c'est ça. J'aime bien parler du concept de friction. C'est-à-dire que pour quelqu'un qui n'est pas dans le pays où la langue est parlée, il y a beaucoup plus de friction parce qu'il faut faire des efforts. Et il faut faire des efforts pour chercher une vidéo sur YouTube qui est en français. En plus, c'est de plus en plus difficile avec la traduction automatique. Il faut faire des efforts pour trouver des livres en français ou pour aller parler à des francophones. C'est difficile. On ne les a pas tout de suite là. Donc, quand on est en France, c'est presque l'inverse. Il y en a presque trop. Et le danger, c'est de se renfermer et de se dire « Ah, mon Dieu, je ne peux pas, il y a trop de français, c'est trop dur. » Et donc, la première chose, c'est vraiment, autant que possible, de ne pas avoir peur. Je sais que c'est plus facile à dire qu'à faire. Mais les Français, en général, quand on essaye de parler français et qu'on est anglophone, ils apprécient ça. Bon, il y en a beaucoup qui essayent de pratiquer l'anglais avec vous parce qu'ils se disent « Oh, un anglais, trop bien, je vais pratiquer mon anglais. » Mais il y a aussi beaucoup de Français qui ont tendance à penser un peu du mal des anglophones, surtout des Américains, comme quoi c'est des gens qui s'attendent à ce que vous parliez anglais, ils veulent faire des efforts, ils ne veulent pas apprendre le français. Et ça, on n'aime pas ça en tant que Français. On apprécie beaucoup, beaucoup, beaucoup que les gens essayent de parler notre langue. Donc déjà, il faut savoir que si vous essayez de parler français, même si vous êtes nul, rien que le fait d'essayer, les Français vont vous apprécier pour ça et vont vouloir vous aider. Donc, il ne faut pas hésiter à dire aux Français « Oui, moi, je veux vraiment parler français. Il faut m'aider. Vous n'êtes pas obligé de me parler en anglais. C'est pas mal de parler en anglais avec eux de temps en temps. Mais la première chose, c'est que, OK, il ne faut pas avoir peur. Il y a beaucoup, beaucoup d'opportunités. Donc, l'avantage, c'est que vous pouvez aller n'importe où et faire ce que vous voulez. Donc, par exemple, si vous aimez le yoga, inscrivez-vous à des cours de yoga en français. Vous avez la possibilité de faire ça. Si vous n'étiez pas en France, ça serait beaucoup plus difficile. Vous auriez des vidéos sur YouTube, mais c'est tout. Si vous aimez faire de la poterie, vous pouvez vous inscrire à un cours de poterie. Je ne vais pas être obligé de donner 10 exemples parce que vous voyez l'idée. Donc, vraiment, l'avantage d'être en France, c'est que vous avez accès à du français tout le temps et c'est très facile. La difficulté, elle est plus mentale. C'est plus dans votre tête où vous allez vous dire « j'ose pas, c'est difficile. Qu'est-ce qui va se passer si je fais une erreur du genre de Netflix and chill? Tout le monde va se moquer de moi. » Ils vont peut-être se moquer de vous un peu à l'intérieur. En général, les gens se moquent pas trop des étrangers parce qu'ils savent que c'est dur d'être étranger dans un pays, surtout si ils l'ont fait eux-mêmes. Après, il y a, bon, vous allez tomber sur des Français qui sont jamais sortis de leur village et qui vont pas comprendre. Ça dépend un peu de où vous êtes en France. Plus vous êtes dans un village, plus c'est dur. Plus vous allez avoir une situation comme celle que je décrivais au début de l'interview, où quand j'étais à Gmundon, les gens ne comprenaient pas du tout ce qui se passait avec moi et quel genre d'extraterrestre j'étais qui ne parlait pas leur dialecte. Bon, ça peut arriver. Mais si vous êtes dans une ville, en général, les gens sont conscients qu'il existe des autres pays avec des autres langues et que si vous êtes un étranger et que vous essayez de parler français, ils vont essayer de vous aider. Et s'ils ne comprennent pas, ne leur parlez pas. Il y a très peu de situations où vous allez être obligé de parler à quelqu'un qui ne va pas être bienveillant. Bon, évidemment, il peut y avoir un conseiller des impôts ou quelqu'un à l'URSSAF ou quelqu'un, je ne sais pas moi, à la caisse d'allocation familiale ou des administrations où là, c'est peut-être les situations les plus désagréables parce que les gens ne sont généralement pas très motivés pour vous aider. En dehors de ces situations qui sont vraiment désagréables, vous pouvez parler que à des gens qui sont bienveillants. Trouver des gens qui ont des choses en commun avec vous. Comme je vous disais, vous pouvez aller au cours de yoga, vous pouvez parler de yoga avec un Français et en général, ils vont apprécier de parler avec vous s'ils ont le temps. Si vous allez chez le coiffeur et quelqu'un est en train de vous couper les cheveux, probablement le coiffeur ou la coiffeuse va se rendre compte que vous n'êtes pas français et va peut-être pas essayer de trop vous parler pour éviter d'avoir des problèmes de communication. Mais vous pouvez lui parler. De toute façon, vous êtes assis là, il est en train de vous couper les cheveux, ça va durer le temps que ça dure. Vous avez l'opportunité d'essayer de parler avec cette personne. Donc, il faut vraiment, parfois, il faut commencer la communication parce que les Français vont souvent pas vous voir, ils vont avoir peur. En fait, j'ai l'impression que peut-être les Français ont peut-être encore plus peur de vous que vous deux. Par exemple, je me souviens d'une fois où quand j'étais à Paris, j'étais avec mon ex-femme. Et comme je parle français, je suis français, quand on va à Paris, on n'essaie pas d'aller dans les endroits touristiques, on essaie de trouver plutôt des petits restaurants. Où ça va être demande de la vraie cuisine française, et puis si les gens ne parlent pas anglais, bah, c'est pas grave, je vais leur parler français. Et donc, on rentre dans un restaurant, il y avait deux serveuses, il n'y avait presque aucun client, il y avait deux serveuses qui étaient assises. On est rentré en ayant notre conversation en anglais, on parlait en anglais tous les deux, et j'ai vu dans le regard des serveuses, elles se sont regardées, elles m'ont regardé nous, et je pouvais pratiquement lire leur pensée. Oh, oh mon Dieu, des étrangers, qu'est-ce qu'on va faire? Et il y avait une sorte de paralysie, ça a duré une espèce de seconde, mais j'ai senti genre. J'ai senti qu'elles avaient vraiment peur de qu'est-ce qu'on va faire. Il y a des gens qui viennent de rentrer dans notre restaurant. C'est notre travail de les servir, mais on ne va pas pouvoir communiquer avec eux. Et je me suis avancé vers une serveuse. J'ai dit bonjour, une table pour deux, s'il vous plaît. Et j'ai vu le soulagement. Ah, il y en a un qui parle français. On ne va pas être obligé d'essayer de parler anglais, je sais pas quoi. Et vraiment, ils apprécient quand ils se rendent compte que quelqu'un dont ils pensaient que cette personne n'allait pas pouvoir parler avec eux et vous se rendent compte que vous pouvez parler, même si ce n'est pas très bien. Les Français vont en général apprécier ça. Bon, vous pouvez toujours tomber sur quelqu'un qui est de mauvaise humeur, ça arrive. Mais il ne faut pas le prendre personnellement. Si vous tombez sur un Français de mauvaise humeur, bon, déjà, c'est souvent le cas, hein, ils râlent un peu, les Français, c'est normal. Mais il y a beaucoup de Français qui vont vouloir vous aider. Donc, oui, j'espère que ça répond aux questions. Je suis encore parti sur une tangente.
Non, ça a très très bien répondu à la question et je veux juste rajouter quelque chose à ce que tu as dit. C'est vraiment important que nous, en tant qu'étrangers, bah, je suis sûr que vous qui regardez cette vidéo, vous savez déjà parce que vous vous intéressez à apprendre la langue. Mais en général, les étrangers, bah, certains étrangers s'attendent à avoir un serveur qui parle anglais. Tu vois, ils essaient même pas de dire bonjour ou merci en français. Ils préfèrent dire hello, excuse me, do you speak English? Et donc, c'est pour ça que je pense que on a le stéréotype des Français qui détestent les anglophones, qui n'essaient même pas de parler français. Si tu essaies même un petit peu, tu rends à l'aise les autres personnes. Et donc, ils vont être beaucoup plus prêts à vous aider, à aller plus loin pour être serviable, pour être oui, pour vous aider. Et quand tu réalises ça, tu réalises qu'en fait, ce stéréotype est complètement faux. Pour moi, c'était vraiment un plaisir, c'était très agréable de découvrir ça, en fait, que les Français ne font pas trop peur en fait, tout est à l'intérieur. Donc, quand commence à parler le français, tu vas voir que les gens en général sont très très ouverts. Mais comme tu as dit, si tu rencontres quelqu'un qui est plus fermé, qui te juge pour ton niveau de français, arrête de lui parler.
Simple, ne parle pas à cette personne. T'as pas besoin de ça dans ta vie. T'as pas besoin de gens qui te jugent ou de gens qui se moquent de toi. Enfin, voilà, ne parle pas à cette personne. Elle a ses problèmes. Tu peux la laisser s'occuper de ses propres problèmes. Et je voulais dire que pour les Français, non, pas pour les Français, en général, pour les gens qui parlent peut-être pas très bien français ou peut-être bien pas très bien la langue de l'autre personne, j'ai une phrase magique. Je me suis rendu compte de ça quand j'essayais de parler à des gens au service client. C'était pour mon ordinateur,
Une phrase
le
magique.
texte.
Une phrase magique. Ok, on adore
Phrase
ça. Ok.
magique. Si vous n'avez pas envie de parler la langue de l'autre personne ou que votre niveau n'est pas très bon en français ou dans n'importe quelle autre langue, dites « Is it okay if I speak English ?» Et ça, quand j'ai trouvé ça a aidé toutes mes interactions. Au début, soit vous pouvez parler un petit peu en français et puis peut-être vous galérez, vous n'y arrivez pas trop. Et vous devez quand même, vous devez acheter cette chose, vous devez avoir ce résultat. Is it okay if I speak English? Et là, si la personne parle anglais, même pas très bien, ils vont faire des efforts parce que vous leur avez demandé la permission. C'est-à-dire que vous n'avez pas supposé que la personne doit parler votre langue ou
Oui,
l'anglais. Bon, l'anglais, c'est.
mais c'est aussi parce que vous avez fait des efforts. C'est
Mais même si je commence la conversation par parce que parfois je suis au téléphone et c'est le troisième customer representative à qui je suis en train de parler. Pour essayer de solutionner un problème avec mon ordinateur, je suis fatigué et eux aussi sont fatigués parce que voilà, c'est pas un travail facile. Même si c'est la première chose que je dis, is it okay if I speak English? Si la personne parle anglais, elle va me dire oui et je vais avoir une conversation beaucoup plus facile que si je commence directement à parler anglais, en supposant que eux, et c'est parce que je leur demande la permission et vu qu'ils m'ont dit oui, ils n'ont plus trop le choix et ils peuvent plus changer d'avis parce qu'il y a le biais il y a le biais de consistance. Non, comment ça s'appelle? Constance. Le biais de constance, où quand vous avez dit oh oui à quelque chose, vous avez continué dans cette direction. C'est une sorte de biais cognitif. Donc, et ça marche assez bien. Donc,
Ok.
voilà, si votre français est pas très bon et vous avez essayé, vous n'avez pas réussi, ou alors vous êtes fatigué et vous devez faire quelque chose et vous ne savez pas comment vous allez vous en sortir, is it okay if I speak English? Si la personne parle anglais, elle va vous parler anglais. Bon, ça ne va pas améliorer votre français, mais au moins vous allez réussir à faire ce que vous devez faire.
Oui. Donc, pour moi, il y a deux astuces là. La première, c'est faites de votre mieux de parler en français, parler français. Et si c'est vraiment nécessaire que l'interaction passe un peu plus fluidement, peut-être que vous êtes pressé, peut-être que l'autre personne est pressée, ou peut-être c'est vraiment technique et c'est essentiel que vous vous compreniez, dites cette phrase magique. Is it okay?
Vous pouvez la dire en français, vous pouvez apprendre à dire cette phrase en français. Est-ce que ça va si on parle anglais? Est-ce qu'on peut
Ah
parler
oui, encore
anglais?
mieux. Ah oui, encore mieux, encore mieux.
Si c'est en France et que la personne est un Français, est-ce qu'on peut parler anglais? Ça marche, oui.
Et tous
C'est
les
pas très dur
anglophones,
d'apprendre cette phrase.
et tous les
C'est pas très
anglophones,
dur d'apprendre cette phrase.
et tous les anglophones qui apprennent le français connaissent cette question. Mais souvent, ils ont peur de la poser parce qu'ils ont peur de.
Ou alors que la personne dise non, mais dans la pratique, ça arrive presque jamais. Ou alors c'est quelqu'un qui ne parle pas du tout anglais.
Oui, mais je pense qu'au début, les gens ont peur de comment ils vont sembler, tu vois, quand ils parlent français. Donc, ils ont même peur de dire, parlez-vous français? Ou vous parlez français? Ou anglais, pardon. Voilà.
Oui, il y a ça aussi.
Oui, il y a ça aussi.
Mais dans l'ensemble, enfin, si vous faites des efforts et qu'ils voient que vous faites des efforts, c'est un bon point pour vous. Donc, les gens, normalement, ne vont pas vous juger plus. Enfin, ils vont vous juger plutôt positivement. Ouais. Oh, quelqu'un qui fait des efforts, ça fait plaisir. Ah, oh, pour une fois, un Anglais qui fait des efforts. Voyez.
Et aussi, moi, je suis souvent trop dans la tête, dans ma tête, dans ma bulle, que quand je cherche mes mots avant d'aller poser une question à quelqu'un, peut-être à la banque, j'attends, il y a une file d'attente, j'attends, donc je cherche mes mots, je me prépare, et donc c'est possible que j'oublie de sourire devant la personne, tu vois. Et ça, c'est vraiment important. Si tu as l'air calme et poli, sympa. L'autre personne est aussi plus ouverte à faire des efforts pour toi. Donc,
Oui, ça c'est, je pense que c'est un très bon type. J'aime bien la manière dont Brandon Bouchard le présente dans un livre qui s'appelle, j'ai oublié, High Performance Habits, je crois. J'espère que c'est lui. Bon, en tout cas, il a une habitude, ça s'appelle Tension to Intention. C'est-à-dire qu'au moment où vous changez de segment, où vous changez l'interaction, donc vous êtes en train, par exemple, vous êtes dans la queue, comme tu disais, et vous êtes en train de penser à vos trucs et à vos mots, etc. Et à un moment, vous arrivez devant la caissière ou le caissier. Et là, ça change. C'est-à-dire que vous êtes à un moment où vous êtes tout seul, puis ensuite vous êtes avec une autre personne. À ce moment-là, ça change. Vous pouvez prendre une seconde ou une demi-seconde pour vous dire, ah, c'est changé. Il faut que je change mon attitude. Et poum, vous pouvez sourire et vous dire, ça y est, je vais. Et vous vous centrez sur cette personne. C'est peut-être un petit peu difficile dans cette situation particulière parce que les caissiers n'ont souvent pas l'habitude de connecter vraiment avec les clients parce que les clients ont l'habitude de se comporter comme s'ils n'étaient pas là. Donc, c'est peut-être pas un très bon exemple. Mais si vous allez dans une situation où vous devez vraiment parler à quelqu'un, c'est bien de se dire, OK, maintenant je vais diriger mon attention vers cette personne et mon énergie, si vous voulez, d'une certaine manière, vers cette personne pour que la connexion se fasse et que la personne se sente reconnue et que vous vous rendez compte que vous avez une connexion en fait. En fait, ça, c'est le genre de truc. Je ne sais pas trop en parler en français parce que j'ai tellement l'habitude d'en parler en anglais que je suis devenu meilleur en anglais qu'en français dans ce genre de domaine. Mais c'est ça l'idée. Like that the person feels that you've acknowledged them and you've recognized them as you know, your equal, basically, and that you have had this connection just for this moment, even if it's very short. And
I
that
think.
really smooths out connections. You know, smile, nice attitude, and don't be too in your head about the French words.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people, myself included, that's how I learned all this stuff is going through it myself, is that, they want to get to a point in French where they feel as comfortable in English, as comfortable as French as they do in English, which is of course really reasonable. And so they're in a rush to get there because it's painful. They're sick of feeling the stress of everyday interactions. But I do think it's smart to have to change the way you approach these interactions because it isn't your native language and this isn't your country, so the culture's different and the language is different. So you just have to accept that you do have to do things like make an effort to connect with this one person, be strategic, be rational and be logical,
To be honest, even if it's in your native language, you should still be doing it. It works a lot better if you do it in like the communication with people works a lot better if you take a moment to connect with the person.
For sure, but I think a lot of this stuff we don't think about if we're monolingual and we've never learned language because we just go about our day, we're rushing around, we're getting through life. But I feel like having learned French, it's forced me to focus on the words and what they mean and how they impact the other person. So it leads you down all these interesting rabbit holes in your mind, which can impact your behavior.
Then ultimately, it can make you even a better speaker of your own language because you think more, like you become more conscious and more mindful of what you do. So that's cool. I like
Exactly.
that.
Yeah, exactly. So, talking about being a better speaker, do you have something like a freebie that you offer new people to help them get better with their French to make consistent progress? What do you have on offer for that?
You want my secret weapon?
Yes.
This is my secret weapon. It's 2 pages, and that's basically it's the backbone of every single program. Like if you ever learn with me, whether it's one-on-one or in a group program, this will be the main thing that you will be using. And so these are basically instructions on how to use it. And this part is the most interesting. I was speaking earlier in the conversation about tasks, and you like this helps you define your list of tasks. All the tasks are all the things that you want to be able to do. So that can be as diverse as buying bread to running a meeting if you have to run a meeting in French. So it will be a very personal thing. Like I think that's the difference between how I work and how you work, Alex, where like most of your people, the people you work with, are English-speaking expats who are in French-speaking countries, and they have a rather general situation that's mostly the same for most of them. This will work even if your situation is completely different because you will have to do a lot of the thinking work to define very clearly, okay, what is fluency for you, and be able to understand and get a vision of you speaking French, your future French-speaking self. And once you've done that, you'll be able to make a list of all the things you want to do. And this list, you can write it here, and this will help you track your progress. I've made this system because I've noticed that the A1, A2, B1, etc. people just, unless you're a language learning professional like me, like I understand that very perfectly. But if you're a regular person and you're not, born with that, or like you haven't studied that for years like I did, you don't understand that. It doesn't make any sense. So I created this system, which is only, it's only four level, and it's for each task, how well can you do it? And it ranges from the one, which is not at all, I have no idea how to do that in French. That's basically beginner. You've not never done this particular thing. To four, which is I can do it easily, no problem at all. So basically that's the definition of fluency. And your goal is once a month to review what you're doing and tick the appropriate columns for every task. And once you have all the ticks in the fourth column, that's your definition of fluency, right?
Okay.
If that makes sense. So this is really like the best thing I have. I use it with every single person who studies with me. And basically, of course, how you move the ticks is by practicing French. So this is free. I will give you the link, Alex, so you can put it down below and you can just get it. And yep, that's the secret weapon.
Oh, well, yeah, guys, if you are interested in that and really being able to set yourself clear targets and see your progress through certain things, that would be sounds like a really fantastic thing to be able to recommend. So thank you very much, Angèle. And I would say to everyone, foncez, no? Foncez, like it's like go for it, go and go ahead and take action on that. Is there anything else that you would like to add before we finish off? Obviously, I'm going to link because I think this is going to be part two of our little collaboration. So the video that I did with Angèle on his channel will already be out. So a link to that is down in the description. Link to your website and your channel will be down there as well. Is there anything else you would like to add for French learners, particularly perhaps expats who or future expats who are watching this video? You'd like to give some advice to them?
Yeah, meditate. I just realized I like to speak about meditation a lot. If you meditate, it will help you be more centered. And I find that for me, it helps you a lot. It helps me a lot communicate in the right language and find the words more easily. So yeah, I just realized that it's something that we could have spoken about in the conversation, but just didn't come up. But yeah, generally, just do anything that you can do to be less stressed out. Because very often, the reason why you're not speaking French as well as you want is because it's more because of stress than because of a lack of actual competence. So you have to trust that the knowledge that you have is in you, and the more relaxed you are, the easier it will be to actually speak French and communicate. So yeah, that's if I have to give the last word is to just trust that all the hard work that you've been doing so far to learn French is in there. And you will be able to let it out if you only relax and trust that you can do it. So yeah, relax and trust, I guess. Last words.
That is so true. That is so true. And I know that I can speak better, whether it was 1 year in, whether it was now 5 years in. I know I speak better if I'm calmer and I'm stress-free because I'm less irritable. I react much better to my mistakes and things like that, you know. So thank you so much.
Yeah, and I think we don't hear this advice enough. I mean, we're starting to hear it a little bit more now, but yeah, it's really important. It makes a huge difference.
Okay, cool. Well, thank you so much, Angel, for joining us here today. Yeah, guys,
Thank
if
you
you're
for
interested,
having me.
go.
Thank you for having me and letting me ramble on your channel.
Yeah, thank you guys for taking the time to watch. Go ahead and check out part one over on Angel's channel. Check out any of the links in the description. And please let us know what you think of everything you've heard here today down in the comments. You know, we love to have a discussion. And oui, bon courage avec le français et continuez. Je vous revois très bientôt. Ok,
À
allez,
bientôt.
au revoir.